I've had my GivEnergy All-in-One battery and gateway installed for a couple of weeks now, so I thought I'd put together this video to go over a few different things about it that might be of interest to you. All unrelated, but hopefully they'll give you a nice overall picture of what it's like to live with and use this product. Let's start with a quick overview of what the GivEnergy All-in-One actually is. It's an AC-coupled home battery that can supply your home with power. You can charge that battery either from the grid at off-peak times when energy is cheaper, or you can fill it with solar energy from your solar panels if you have them.
So it's called an all-in-one because the inverter and the battery are both combined into this single unit. So the inverter is kind of at the top and the battery is down at the bottom. That means that there's a lot less to go wrong when the installer fits it, so there's no extra cabling needed between both of those devices.
The battery has a capacity of 13.5 kilowatt hours, which means that if your house was drawing constantly at 1 kilowatt, this battery would last about 13 hours. The inverter has a capacity of 6 kilowatts, that's power, which is the speed that the energy can be used. Your oven might draw 3 kilowatts, your kettle 2 kilowatts, so the inverter could happily provide enough power to cover both of those loads at the same time with a bit left over. Most battery inverter systems can only deliver 3, 3.5 kilowatts of power, so this 6 kilowatt specification is a great bonus.
So the all-in-one is a great product in itself, but what is this extra mystery box here for? Well, this is where the magic happens. This is the gateway. It sits between your meter and your consumer unit or fuse box or whatever you want to call it. And in the event of a power cut, the gateway will detect that and cut your home off from the grid, so your home is effectively isolated from the grid and just running off batteries.
Most battery systems can't do that. Previously, you might have had the EPS output of your battery wired up to a backup socket or your lights or something, but you couldn't really have a whole home backup with full automatic changeover without spending big money on something like a Tesla Powerwall. When there's a power cut, the DNO, who manage the power network for you, require that nothing live, such as a battery, is connected to their network. This is just in case someone is working on the wires to fix something and to ensure that they don't get electrocuted.
This is inside the gateway, and you can see that there is a connection for your all-in-one, so this goes straight to the all-in-one inverter. There is a connection for your solar PV inverter, which is quite good because the gateway can actually keep your solar panels up and running during a power cut. So normally if you lose power to your home, your solar panels would stop generating too because the inverter needs power. But with this system, the solar inverter actually gets power from the all-in-one so it can keep on running. You can also connect your EV charger up here. Now, I've got mine connected grid side, which means that it's not backed up by battery, which is exactly what I want, but the all-in-one and gateway can monitor it, but it means that if there is a power cut and I'm charging the car will stop charging. That's intentional because the car can pull up to 7 kilowatts and the inverter can only supply 6 kilowatts, so I really don't want to risk overloading the inverter if we have a power cut.
Once it's all installed, you want to configure it to work best for you. Now, the settings that work best for you might be different to the settings that work best for someone else. It all really depends on what sort of energy tariff you have or if you have solar or not. There are two official ways you can configure it too, either using the GivEnergy app or using the web portal. Let's take a look at the app first. Now, I've got my phone here to show you the app, and this is the very first page that you see when you open it. Now the first thing you'll want to do is enable the system mode settings cog, and you do that by tapping on the menu in the top left, going down to settings and then preferences. And you can see the menu option here, show system modes button. So I'm going to turn that on and then I can go back out and you'll see there's a new cog here in the top right hand corner. If I tap that, there we go, you can see my default settings. Now, I've got solar panels and I'm on the Octopus Go tariff, which gives me cheap energy prices from 12:30 till 4:30 a.m. So you can see my charge mode is set to solar plus grid. You've got the option of just solar there if you wanted. Now, start and end times are 12:30 till 4:30 a.m., which are aligned with my tariff, and I've got the charge up to 100% enabled. That means that between those 4 hours that are set up as the start and end time, it will charge the battery up to full. Now, the charge power is 6 kilowatts, which means it's going to charge at full speed, but I could reduce that if I wanted to. So those settings deal with charging the battery. So it will charge from solar during the day if there's any excess, and it will charge during off-peak times up to 100% too from the grid. Now let's have a look at those other settings. These ones down the bottom, these control how the battery discharges, and this is very important to understand, or you can end up thinking your battery is faulty when it's just a misconfiguration. My battery discharge mode is set to dynamic. That means that outside of the charge hours you set above, it will discharge the battery to meet your demand. If your home is using 500 watts, the battery will supply 500 watts. The alternative is to set a scheduled discharge, and this is quite a common mistake new users make from what I've seen on the forums. If you set a scheduled discharge, the battery will not supply your home outside of those times. My advice is to just leave it in dynamic mode and let it do its thing. If you have a fancy tariff like Octopus Flux where you want to force an export to make a bit of money, then you should look at tariff automations instead. Leave this in dynamic, I promise you. Finally, the reserve value at the bottom is how much you want to save in case of a power cut. So I've got mine set to 10% here. The other way to configure it is via the portal. So just browse to portal.giveenergy.cloud and log in. From the menu on the left, you want to choose My Inverters. And if you've got the all-in-one, which hopefully you have if you're watching this video, the one you want to look at is this one here, because you've got two lines, one for the gateway, one for the all-in-one. Look at this all-in-one line, scroll all the way to the side under the actions column, and you'll see inverter information. So click on that and it should open up a new page just for that inverter. There we go. Now, if you click on the settings tab, you'll be able to configure the settings exactly the same as you can in the app. Now, there's a bit of a naming discrepancy here between the app and the portal. The first section is named Eco, and that is basically the same as dynamic mode in the app. So if you go to the Eco tab and set that as enabled, you can then go to timed charge. And this is where you set the timed charge to pull from the grid. So again, my times here are aligning with Octopus Go, so I've got it enabled. I've got it set from 12:30 to 4:30 a.m. and it's charging to 100% right here. And you can also see that we've got a timed discharge, which is disabled, and a timed export section that's disabled as well. Now, if you don't know what they are for, then you are probably not going to be using them. They really are for special case scenarios. So finally, go and check the battery options section, and this is where you set the power rates that they can charge and discharge at, and also your reserve that keeps you a little bit of spare battery capacity for use in power cuts. And if you're a Home Assistant user, then you will of course want to connect that to your shiny new battery. You'll need an add-on called GivTCP, and I have another video all about how to configure that. At the time of putting together this video, the video about GivTCP is starting to get a bit out of date. The installation process hasn't changed too much yet, so I'll put a link to that in the description, and it'll talk you through installing it and the various components needed. When GivTCP gets its next major overhaul, I'll re-record that tutorial and update the description in this video. For now, I'm just going to show you the differences you need to be aware of in order to get it working. So here's the configuration page for GivTCP. All you really need to do with the all-in-one is fill in your inverter's IP address. Now, I've got another video on how to find out the IP address of your inverter, so I'll put a link to that down in the description. With the all-in-one, the important details to remember are that you put a quantity of zero batteries. It's just a quirk of how the all-in-one works, really. And then you have to tick this little toggle box to say that it is an all-in-one. And that's it. All of the other settings are exactly the same as you would configure for any other GivEnergy battery, so you've still got the solar forecast stuff, you've got the web dashboard if you want it. So those are literally the only two differences you need to be worried about: setting zero batteries and ticking the is it an all-in-one box. So this is great for a tariff like Octopus Go, but what if you want a more complex configuration for a tariff like Octopus Flux or Cozy? Well, at the moment there's no simple way to deal with it. You need to create automations using a third party. It's worth checking out Octopus R&D Labs too, because they can potentially schedule your inverter for a smart tariff. It definitely works for Octopus Go, and I've heard it works for Flux too, and also Agile. I'll put a web link down in the description for you, so you can go and have a play around with that too. If you'd like to take a look at using Home Assistant, then it's at this point that I'll need to direct you to a couple of online resources. First, there's a Facebook group called GivEnergy GivTCP Users Community, and you'll find a lot of people on there asking questions and willing to answer any questions you might have, specifically about GivTCP and integrating with Home Assistant. Secondly, there's the GivEnergy Community Forum. Sign up at community.givenergy.cloud and you'll find all sorts of useful bits of information in there. Anyway, I hope you found this useful. If you did, then please give the video a like. If there's anything you'd like me to cover in a future video, then please drop me a note in the comments, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel to see more like this. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.